Have you had an encounter with Mr. Tall, Dark, and Scary? And would you like to hear it narrated on this channel? Well, if so, send me an email with all the details. You can email me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. Well, hey there, everyone. I'm so glad you could make it this evening. You know, it's almost dusk out there, and you know what that means. It means it's time to get your booty in the saddle. We're getting ready to hit the trail and head out to Sasquatch Valley. Now, with luck tonight, we'll get there just as the Sasquatches in that valley head out for their nocturnal activities. And maybe if we're real lucky, we'll catch a glimpse of a few of them. Are you ready? Me too. Let's go. Dear Nance, maybe I'm not alone here, but I like a bedtime story. I like to listen to your Buckeye Bigfoot YouTube channel before going to bed. But it made me recall and gather experiences from my youth and put them together and think, aha. Back in 1976, a cousin and I were visiting with my sister and brother-in-law one summer. They lived in an old town called Frico City, California. It wasn't a city, but used to be a boys' camp that wasn't being used for that anymore. Anyway, my sister lived in an old farmhouse at the outskirts of this town. It was on a remote piece of property. My cousin and I were about 14 and 15. We decided to take a walk down an old logging road before the sun went down, which wasn't far from that old farmhouse. We got about a quarter mile down the logging road when we got to feel weird, like we were being watched, and a feeling of fear came over us. Then we smelled something bad. I mean, the smell was horrific and putrid, like something dead mixed with poop, pee, and puke. Back then, people told tales of Bigfoot in that area, but I never believed them. I thought that they were just that, tales. So we started thinking about those rumors and sightings that people had been talking about in that area. So we turned and ran back fast to my sister's house. I contacted my cousin today to verify that our experience was valid. She said, in her words, "I remember this. I remember walking down that road at night, bats flying overhead and smelling something horrible and beating feet back to the house." It freaked us out. I'm so glad I made contact with her today to verify the experience that I recently recalled. Later, now this is the part that I just gathered more than 50 years later, but later that evening some old man came to the door pounding on the front door. I answered it and he was frantic. He said, "My name is Mr. Rooster," and it could have been Wooster. Then he said, "And I can't find some of my sheep. They're gone." Some of his sheep were missing and he was looking for them. This old man looked scared. Crazy how it took me over 50 years for me to put all of this together just since watching your Buckeye Bigfoot videos and other Bigfoot channels on YouTube. But that old man probably lost his sheep due to the culprit of that foul smell and the tales that the locals had been sharing with us vulnerable young girls. That town of Frico City had many strange encounters, many UFO sightings as well. Okay. Just sharing an experience from when I was young, a teenage girl, back in 1976. P.S. I moved to Oregon where it's safer. Ha ha. And now a word from our tiny overlord, Sage. Now back to your regularly scheduled program. In 2023, I moved up to British Columbia to be with my long-distance boyfriend, Eddie. On September 8, 2023, we were with some of his friends at Chilliwack Lake fishing and boating. We left as it was getting dark. His friends left first, then we were just a few minutes behind them. Along the way, me and Eddie started to have an argument. It got pretty heated. I didn't know at the time how far we were from home, but I told him to let me out of the car. He stopped, but before I could open the door, he locked all the doors. Then we went back and forth with me unlocking the door and him locking it back before I could pull the door handle to get out. But at one point, I hit the right moment between locking and unlocking, and I got that car door open. I guess when he pulled over, he didn't think I would really get out, but I was really mad. Well, I got out, and I started walking, and he started following right behind me. He was honking the horn and yelling at me to get back in the car. I wouldn't, though, because I was too mad. Once or twice, he almost nudged me with the front of the car. So I stepped down further off the pavement far into the grassy area. I've included a Google Maps shot of what that road kind of looks like. Now, picture it at night. His headlights behind me lit up the road ahead for me. A few cars passed us, and a couple slowed down and they looked carefully, but only one rolled down a window to ask if I was okay or needed help. I assured them I was okay, and we were just having a lover's argument. I really wasn't okay, but the people that stopped, they looked pretty scary themselves. No way I was getting in the car with them either. A few more minutes of this, and it went on, and the headlights coming the opposite direction slowed down, and then suddenly they stopped opposite of us. Turned out it was Eddie's friends who had left right before us. They thought maybe Eddie's car had broken down, and they came back when they realized we weren't behind them anymore. They got the idea of what was really going on, and they were kind enough to offer to give me a ride. And I didn't want to ride with them any more than I did with Eddie. And part of our argument was because of them, but that's another story. I politely told them no. They finally left, and Eddie was getting madder by the second. Neither of us were thinking clearly. And while I can't say for certain about Eddie, I know that my anger and stubbornness was leftover fuel, so to speak, from the alcohol that had been consumed that day while we were out at the lake. But let me be clear. I was not drunk. I was not a sloppy drunk. I was not falling down. I had had my last beer over 2 hours prior to this. I still had a slight buzz going, but there was nothing more than that. I was upright, walking, and talking clearly, and I have a clear memory of everything that happened, especially of what happened next. I had been keeping my head down or looking slightly just ahead of where I was walking because I didn't want to trip on anything in the grass. Suddenly, I hear Eddie screaming. I mean screaming like a banshee, and he's yelling at me to hurry up and get in the car. But he's not yelling. I mean, not like he was before. His voice changed. It was higher. It was panicked. I looked up, and then I looked back at him. And at the same time, he zoomed the car forward and cut over to block me from going further unless I detoured way around the nose of the car, which was now most of the way off the road. He leans over. He opens the door, and he's screaming bloody murder at me that there was a bear up there to get in the car. I was new to the area, and I had been warned of a lot of things lurking in the area, things like bears. But no one told me that Sasquatch was ever going to be a concern in the area, so I don't think either of us were thinking of that. I mean, I had heard stories of Sasquatch, of course, but I didn't take them seriously. It's not that I believed or that I didn't believe. I just didn't think about it. I thought it was all native legend. And I thought it must have been based on some wild people living out there or something. Truthfully, I heard about it, but I never gave it any thought. But I look ahead at what Eddie was pointing at, and he's screaming bloody murder at me still. I look down the road, and in the headlights there was this enormous, hair-covered, bear-looking animal thing at the side of the road. I think I thought bear because that's what Eddie said. I saw that it was turned slightly, looking in our direction. If I had kept walking, I might have walked right into it because I'd been walking with my head mostly down. I saw a golden eye glare come from it, about 4 feet off the ground. Then I saw it had a massive chest that was turned directly towards us, but the rest of it was warped and wrong-looking. Then I figured it out very quick, because it stood up to about 8 feet tall or more. What I saw could not have been a bear. There was no snout, no ears, and those legs. They weren't the back legs of a bear that bowed out at the hips, and it didn't waddle when it eventually walked. Those were straight legs, and tall. There was just a second that I remember everything was quiet. Eddie wasn't yelling, and all I heard was the car running. But I was locked into looking at it down the road. It was covered in a very heavy dark fur all over. Its face had some fur on it, but the eye area, the cheekbones, and the lip area were dark, like it was leather. There was no texture that I saw there like there was fur. I remember the eyes were very wide set in the face, and the lips were thin and drawn wide. The nose was rounded like ours, but a little flatter. Just a second went by after it stood up, like it was waiting to see if we were going to stay there. Then it started quickly crossing the highway. It looked at us once more, and then it was gone into the darkness of the trees on the other side of the road. My heart was beating right out of my chest. My fright got the best of me, though, and I quickly got back in the car. The problem was, Eddie had swerved so far off the shoulder into the grass that he couldn't get back on the road because the ground was very moist, and one of the back wheels was no longer making real contact with the pavement all the way because the car was tipped at an angle off the pavement. After about a minute of trying to go forward and backwards and forwards and backwards and not getting any traction, Eddie made me get in the driver's seat, and he got out and quickly pushed the car. I'm sure his adrenaline was very high because it didn't take long to push that car out and back onto the road. He quickly got back in the car, and we headed back towards home, stunned, unbelieving of what we had both just seen. We talked about it all the way, and of course we knew there was only one answer for what it had been. Sasquatch. The next day, Eddie called up his ex-father-in-law, who is a man of the First Nations, though I don't know or recall what tribe. Eddie still had a really good relationship with his ex-father-in-law, and he was more than happy to talk to us about what had happened. We all three went out the next day trying to find where it had happened, but we couldn't. We drove all the way back to the lake and drove slowly back toward Chilliwack, looking. We were looking specifically for the tire tracks that Eddie's car must have made when he drove off the shoulder, but we never did find them. After that, I was informed of how deeply the natives of the area held Sasquatch in a high regard, and that he is no legend to them, but a very real human type who's just another form of tribe. If I had heard all of that before I saw one, I would have politely listened and dismissed it. But after seeing what I saw, I do believe them. We never did find out where it happened, so we could never get any tracks or any evidence. And though we had a couple of beers each that day, we were not drunk. Let me repeat that. We were not drunk. And we both have the exact same memory of what happened and what it looked like. Eddie's ex-father-in-law said that he thought it came down to see what all the noise was between Eddie yelling and the car horn. He said it may have been watching and waiting, hoping that Eddie would drive on and leave me alone on the road in the dark. I then received a stern fatherly type lecture from this man that I should never walk in the dark alone out there, because Sasquatch are very quick to take a lone woman, especially if she is young as I was. He didn't go into further details, thankfully, but his meaning was clear. He didn't have to go into further details. I understood. But I didn't feel that that's what it was doing at all. I think it was just waiting to see if it was safe to go across the road. Maybe it had been curious, but I don't think it was looking to take me. Maybe if we had just kept getting closer and closer, it would have jumped up and ran when we forced its hand, so to speak. I can't say for sure, but if it was wanting to take me, I think it would have been following along in the darkness at the edge of the trees, and that if it wanted to, it could have ran up, grabbed me, and pulled me off into the trees and up the mountains, and there wouldn't have been a single thing Eddie or anyone could have done about it. So, Nance, that's how I almost walked up onto a Sasquatch one night on a dark road east of Chilliwack in British Columbia. And no, I'm not with Eddie anymore. It just didn't work out. Between his mood swings and then the constant threat of taking me to Sasquatch land and leaving me there every time he got angry, well, I decided it was time to split from that place, and I haven't looked back. Other than the Sasquatch and Eddie himself, I actually enjoyed the area of Chilliwack. The people were very nice, and the area is breathtakingly beautiful. But sadly, I will probably never go back there for the rest of my days. Signed, Kayla E. from Seattle, Washington. All right, everyone. Well, thank you for joining me tonight, and I hope you didn't mind our tiny little furry overlord, Sage, popping in between the stories. You know, I had some nasty little people mentioning they didn't like hearing cats on this podcast. Too bad. I'll put a cat in if I feel like it. You can always fast forward. Anyway, everyone, again, thank you so much for joining me tonight. And, you know, me and Sage, we all send our love to you. Otherwise, I don't have much else to fill you in on. I still don't know if I'm doing a live stream anytime soon. I'm still extremely sensitive to bright lights. I'm having trouble driving during the day unless it's overcast outside. But otherwise, don't forget, we're going to meet up again in just a couple days. And you know the drill. Always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. Me and the furry overlord, we love you.